Hi friends, I welcome you for this sixth lecture on module 3 in engineering physics with subject code 18PHY12/22. Myself Dr. Mahesh Lohit KS, associate professor and head department of physics, ATME College of Engineering, Mysuru, here to discuss the second chapter in module 3, that is electromagnetic waves. The contents of discussion in the today's session are: the first topic that we are about to discuss is the introduction to electromagnetic waves. Next, we shall derive an expression for electromagnetic waves in terms of electric field in vacuum. Then we shall understand about the plane electromagnetic waves, and finally we shall study the polarization of electromagnetic waves. So these are the topics of today's discussion. What are electromagnetic waves? What is their origin? These electromagnetic waves are theoretically put forward, or the concept of electromagnetic waves was theoretically put forward by James Clerk Maxwell based on Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. Faraday's law states that a time-varying field, electric field, generates a time-varying magnetic field and vice versa. So this is evident from Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. Therefore, based on Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction, Maxwell predicted the generation of electromagnetic waves, and the electromagnetic wave consists of time-varying electric and magnetic fields which are along mutually perpendicular directions. If this is the direction of variation of the electric field, this will be the direction of variation of the magnetic field. They are mutually perpendicular, and this variation propagates in space, so that the direction of propagation is perpendicular to the plane containing electric and magnetic field vectors. So the direction of propagation is always perpendicular to the electric and magnetic field variations, and again these magnetic field and electric field, they are mutually perpendicular, and such a wave is called as electromagnetic wave. And it's the motion of fields, it's the propagation of fields, hence it does not require any material medium. So electromagnetic wave can propagate through vacuum. So there are various origins for this electromagnetic wave. For example, an oscillating charge produces electromagnetic wave. For example, an electron absorbs energy, it goes to higher energy state and comes back to ground state, an electromagnetic wave is produced. And if the electron does it continuously, then continuously electromagnetic waves are emitted. And similarly, if you consider nucleus emits an electromagnetic wave which is called gamma radiation. And also, when an electron is accelerated, and if it hits a target material, there it interacts with the nucleus of the atom and it gets radially accelerated. During that, energy is emitted which is called Bremsstrahlung, and which are known as X-rays. So this is about the origin of electromagnetic waves. And let us watch the simulation with respect to the electromagnetic waves.
But Maxwell explained that accelerating charges produce both an electric field and a magnetic field that varies with respect to time. And these fields propagate in the form of a wave called the electromagnetic wave. To explain the production of an electromagnetic wave, let us consider an oscillating charge, which refers to an accelerating charge, oscillating along the y-axis with some constant frequency. The oscillating charge produces an oscillating electric field along the direction of the oscillations of the charge and propagates along the x-axis. Here, The frequency of the electric field is equal to the frequency of the oscillating charge. We know that an electric field changing with respect to time produces a magnetic field. The oscillating electric field produces a magnetic field which oscillates perpendicular to the direction of the oscillations of the electric field, that is, along the z-axis, and propagates along the direction of the x-axis. Now, the oscillating magnetic field produces an electric field which is oscillating perpendicular to the direction of the oscillations of the magnetic field and propagates along the x-axis. Thus, the oscillating electric field and the oscillating magnetic field regenerate each other and propagate along the x-axis. This wave is called an electromagnetic wave.
So, I am sure this simulation helped you to visualize the electromagnetic waves. The next topic of discussion is a wave equation for electromagnetic waves in vacuum in terms of electric field, which is a very important derivation. We shall derive the wave equation. To start with, we consider two of the Maxwell's equations. The first one is the Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction, which relates the interacting time-varying electric and magnetic fields. And the second equation is Maxwell-Ampere law, which relates the curl of the magnetic field with the current density. Here, the curl of H is current density plus displacement current density. So, using these two equations, we shall derive the wave equation for electromagnetic waves. Here, we know that this D, electric flux density, is equal to epsilon E. This epsilon is called permittivity of free space, and it is given by epsilon is equal to epsilon naught epsilon r. Epsilon naught is permittivity of free space, and epsilon r is relative permittivity, or it is also called as dielectric constant. And similarly, the magnetic flux density B is equal to mu into H. H is the magnetic field strength, and this mu is called permeability, and it is given by mu is equal to mu naught into mu r. Mu naught is permeability of free space, and mu r is relative permeability. Substituting for the B and D in these two equations, that is in equation 1 and in equation 2, we get this curl of E as minus mu into the rate of change of H with respect to T, okay, that is the magnetic field strength H, because B is equal to mu H. So, we get this equation. Then also curl of H is J plus epsilon dou E by dou T, that is rate of change of electric field strength with respect to time. So, here we have made the substitution for D as D is equal to epsilon E. So, the equations 3 and 4 are obtained by making substitutions for D and B. The next step is, we shall take curl on both sides the equation of this equation 3. So, we shall take curl on LHS, and also we shall take curl on the RHS. So, this becomes del cross here, and even on the right hand side it becomes del cross. Now, this del is a spatial differential operator, whereas dou by dou t is the time differential. So, we can swap these two. Therefore, we get on left hand side curl of E, on the right hand side this mu dou by dou t into del cross H, because we can swap these two operators. We know that this A cross B cross C, according to vector analysis, is given by B into A dot C, okay, and c into and minus c into a dot b. So this is the rule according to the vector vector analysis. So let us apply this particular rule to the LHS. So del cross E, first term is B into A dot C, we take B, this is B, this is A, and this is C, right? So B is del, then A dot C, that is del dot E, that is the divergence of E, minus C into A dot B. A dot B is del dot del is del square. So therefore we get del square E. So this is the equation that we get after simplification according to the rule of vector analysis, that is A cross B cross C is equal to B into A dot C minus C into A dot B. So we know that as per Maxwell's equations, divergence of D is equal to the charge density, and again D is equal to epsilon E, and divergence of E is rho V by epsilon, because here we shall substitute for D is equal to epsilon E. So when I substitute for epsilon is a constant, so therefore this operator doesn't operate on it, and you can take it to the denominator, therefore you will get divergence of E is equal to rho V by epsilon. So we can substitute that here, the divergence of the electric field. So after substitution we get this, that is divergence of E is nothing but rho V by epsilon. So we get curl of E is del operator of rho V by epsilon minus del square E. So we shall substitute this equation 6 in equation 5. What is equation 5? That equation 5 is here. This is the equation. We simplified the LHS, and this is the RHS. Okay. So we have the LHS here, and we shall substitute the same in equation 5. We get this as the left hand side, and this is the right hand side of the equation. Right. So we shall simplify this equation. So to simplify this, what we shall do? On the right hand side, we shall substitute for this H here. We shall substitute for this del cross H. What is del cross H? We shall go back. The del cross H is given by this equation, that is equation 2, that is current density plus displacement current density. So we shall substitute for del cross H. We have this here. So this is the left hand side and this is the right hand side. In left hand side we have the del of rho V by epsilon minus del square E is equal to minus mu into dou by dou T plus J plus epsilon dou E by dou T. So this is the equation 8. So we shall simplify this further. Say we shall multiply throughout by negative sign. If we multiply throughout by negative sign, this becomes minus, this becomes plus, right? And this becomes plus. So retain this del square E on the LHS, then bring this second term, that is mu dou E by dou T of epsilon into dou E by dou T, this mu into epsilon, they get multiplied. Dou by dou T of dou by dou T is dou square E by dou T square, or dou square by dou T square of E. So we get this term, and this term is moved to RHS. So we have del of dou rho V by epsilon, and this term, the first term, that is mu dou J by dou T, that is rate of change of the current density with respect to time, is kept as it is on the right hand side, and we get this equation. So this is the equation what we get when we simplify the Faraday's law and Maxwell's law by eliminating the magnetic field. Now let us try to analyze and understand this equation 9, which is very, very important. So the left hand side of this equation is a wave equation which represents a propagating electromagnetic wave. Whereas this right hand side represents the origin of electromagnetic wave. So this term, it's a spatial variation, represents a spatial variation of E along with this with respect to time. That is, the second term represents the variation with respect to time. And this part, the divergence of the gradient of charge density and the rate of change of current density, these two are related to the origin of electromagnetic waves. Here, this mu and epsilon, already we know they are absolute permittivity and absolute permeability. Mu is absolute permeability and epsilon is absolute permittivity of isotropic homogeneous medium. And in case of propagation of electromagnetic wave in free space there is nothing, isn't it? It's free, it is vacuum. So this current density J will be 0, then rho will be equal to 0. Therefore, this mu will be equal to mu naught and also epsilon will be equal to epsilon naught. Therefore, equation 9 could be written as del square E minus mu naught by epsilon naught dou square E by dou t square is equal to 0. This is the equation of electromagnetic wave in free space in terms of electric field. So, thus we derive the equation for electromagnetic wave in free space. From this equation, we can also calculate the velocity of light or velocity of electromagnetic wave. This term, when we compare this equation with the wave equation, this term represents 1 by v square, which is same as 1 by c square because the electromagnetic wave is propagating in vacuum. So therefore, this 1 by v c square must be equal to mu naught epsilon naught. This implies c is equal to under square root 1 over mu naught epsilon naught. So mu naught is 4 pi into 10 power minus 7. Then this epsilon naught is 8.85 into 10 power minus 12 farad meter minus 1, and if we substitute, we get the value of C as approximately 3 into 10 power 8 meter second minus 1, and this is the velocity of electromagnetic wave in vacuum. Having derived an equation for electromagnetic waves in terms of electric field in vacuum, let us understand plane electromagnetic waves. What are plane electromagnetic waves? Plane electromagnetic waves are the electromagnetic waves which travel in a particular direction and are uniform along mutually orthogonal directions, and such electromagnetic waves are called plane electromagnetic waves. So plane electromagnetic waves travel in one direction and uniform about the two mutually perpendicular directions or orthogonal directions. If this is the direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave and these are the orthogonal directions, it will be uniform. And what is an electromagnetic wave? An electromagnetic wave consists of time-varying electric and magnetic fields, and these time-varying electric and magnetic fields are mutually perpendicular and they are propagating. As they are propagating electric and magnetic fields, they are varying. You can see the variations here. This particular electromagnetic wave is traveling along x-axis, propagating along x-axis. Electric variation, that is electric field variation, is along y-axis. And magnetic field variation is along z-axis. It means the variation of electric and magnetic fields is confined to a plane, that is a yz plane. So it is confined to the yz plane. So let us understand the variation of electric field and the variation of magnetic field in terms of the wave function. So let us consider a plane electromagnetic wave that is propagating along x-axis, and the time varying electric and magnetic fields are, you know, along y and z directions as per the previous diagram what we, you know, refer to here. This is the electric field variation and this is the magnetic field variation and this is the propagating direction. So here the variation of electric field E and its propagation could be written as A cos 2 pi by lambda into x minus ct into j cap. So electric field is varying along y axis and this represents the propagation part. The value of E at a given distance x, at a given position x and at a given instant t. Similarly, the magnetic field variations are along the z axis, and here if you just check, this B is 1 by CA, the amplitude of this magnetic field variation is 1 by C into A, that is into cos into 2 pi by lambda into x minus ct into k cap. The variation of B is along the z axis, and this part represents the propagation and it represents the value of B at position x, okay, at a point x at a given instant of time t. So this is the amplitude of the electric variations, electric field variations, let me call it as EY, and this is the variation of magnetic field, let me call it as BZ, that is the amplitude of variation of magnetic field. If we take the ratio of these two, that is EY by BZ, we get C, means it is the velocity of light. The ratio of amplitude of electric variation to the magnetic variation gives the velocity of light. This is the last topic of today's discussion, that is polarization of electromagnetic wave. Let us understand the polarization of electromagnetic waves. Electromagnetic waves are transverse in nature, as we discussed. It is because of the reason the electric and magnetic fields are in mutually perpendicular directions and perpendicular to the direction of propagation. Let us consider an electromagnetic wave propagating along z axis. Let us say it is out of the paper or out of the screen, and we have this y axis here and this is x axis here. This is y, and this dot represents the z axis is towards us, and that is the direction of propagation. Now let us say the electric vector E is oriented at an angle theta with respect to x. So here this electric vector E, electric field vector E, can be resolved into two components, two mutually perpendicular components. Along y axis it is EY, along x axis it is EX, right? So this E could be resolved into two components. Here we are not bothered about the variation of magnetic field because we derived and considered only the variation of electric field. Let us forget about the variation of magnetic field. Now obviously it will be perpendicular to the electric field and perpendicular to the direction of propagation. So we have consider the electric field and two of its components, EX and EY, along x and y directions. So E has been resolved. We shall now discuss the types of polarization in electromagnetic waves. This classification is based on the magnitudes of x and y components of electric field and the phase angle between the two. So the classification of polarization of electromagnetic waves is as follows. The first type of polarization is called linear polarization, and the electromagnetic waves are called linearly polarized electromagnetic waves. The second type is circular polarization, and the waves are called circularly polarized electromagnetic waves. And the third type of polarization is elliptical polarization, and the waves are called elliptically polarized electromagnetic waves. Now we shall understand this in detail. with the help of this visualization. Let us play the visualization and understand. So see the first picture here. Here the electric field is varying and it is propagating along the z-axis, and it intersects with this plane as a straight line. You can see the variation of electric field here is linear. So such a polarization is called linear polarization. You can watch in the second picture, the electric vector is rotating. As the wave is propagating, the electric vector is rotating. Its length remains constant, or its magnitude remains constant, but its angle keeps on changing. Then its intercept on the plane is nothing but a circle, or the tip of the electric vector traces a circle on this particular plane. So such a polarization is called circular polarization. And the third type is elliptical polarization. In elliptical polarization, the length or the magnitude of the electric vector keeps on changing. If it is maximum here, it decreases, it becomes minimum here, and maximum, minimum, it keeps on changing, so that its interception with the plane traces an ellipse. So these are the types of polarizations in electromagnetic waves. The first kind of polarization in electromagnetic waves is linear polarization, and the electromagnetic waves are called linearly polarized electromagnetic waves. In case of linear polarization, the amplitudes of x and y components of the electric field vector may or may not be equal, but they are in phase or they are in unison. To understand this better, let us consider a diagram here. So we have two axes here, x-axis and y-axis. Let E be the electric field vector, and this is the electric field vector of electromagnetic wave. And we know that in case of electromagnetic wave, the electric field vector changes or varies with respect to time. Now the magnitude of this vector E keeps on changing. It decreases and it increases. Now this E could be resolved into two components, one along the x-axis, and this component is called x component Ex, and another one Ey, that is the y component. As the magnitude of this E, the vector E, decreases, the values of this components or the magnitudes of the components also decreases, but the variation is in unison. For example, when the electric field vector is of maximum value, or the magnitude is, when the magnitude is maximum, the magnitudes of Ey and Ex, they are maximum. And when the amplitude of electric field vector is zero, then the magnitudes of Ey and Ex, they are also zero. So as this E decreases, this Ey and Ex, they decrease in unison. And also, as the direction of this electric field vector changes and it increases, the values of Ex and Ey, or the magnitudes of Ex and Ey, they also increase in unison. In addition to that, the tip of the electric vector traces a straight line as the electric field varies. So the electric field vector, the magnitude increases, it decreases, it increases in the opposite direction, and again it decreases. So during this, the electric field vector traces a linear path, and hence this polarization is called linear polarization. This could be better understood with the help of a simulation here. So here, this is the x component and this is the y component, and the combined component will be in this direction. Let us play this simulation. You can observe, when x component is maximum, y component is also maximum. When x is minimum, y component is also minimum, and the combined vector varies, or it traces a straight line on this plane. So this is an example of linear polarization and I hope it is better understood. The linear polarization is better understood with the help of this simulation. The second kind of polarization of electromagnetic waves is called circular polarization, and the electromagnetic waves are called circularly polarized electromagnetic waves. In case of circular polarization, the amplitudes of x and y components of electric field vector are equal in magnitude, but they are out of phase by 90 degree, or there is a phase difference of 90 degree between the two. It means if the x component is maximum, y component will be minimum, and if the y component is maximum, x component will be minimum. And hence this electric field vector, it rotates and the tip of the vector traces a circle, and hence it is called circularly polarized electromagnetic wave. To understand this better, let us draw this sketch. We have a coordinate system, and in this coordinate system, this is the x-axis, this is the y-axis, and let us say we have an electric field vector here, and this electric field vector is rotating at a given instant of time. This is the y component, and it is denoted by Ey, and this is the x component, it is denoted by Ex. As the time progresses with respect to time, this electric field vector keeps on rotating and the tip traces a circle. Say at a given instant of time, this electric field vector is here. Now the magnitude of the y component of the electric field vector is equal to the magnitude of the electric field vector, but whereas the magnitude of the x component is zero, because the electric field vector is oriented along the y-axis. As it turns, as it rotates, then finally it aligns at a given instant of time, it aligns along the x-axis. When it aligns along the x-axis, the magnitude of the x component is equal to E, that is the magnitude of the electric field vector, whereas the y component is zero. Again, this rotates further and it traces a circle. During that, here the y component is maximum, x component is zero, here x component is maximum again, y component is zero, again it comes back to this point, here y component is maximum and x component is zero. So when one component is zero, the other component is maximum and vice versa, hence they are out of phase. So such a polarization is called circular polarization. Here the tip of the electric field vector traces a circle. This could be better understood with the help of a simulation. We have a simulation here. In this blue variation represents the x component, variation of the x component. The red one describes the variation of the y component. And this arrow represents the net electric field vector. And this net electric field vector rotates. And this net electric field vector is given by the combination of the x and y components. If you watch this animation or the simulation carefully, you can find that when x component is maximum, the y component is minimum. So I will play the simulation for you. Now you can observe here x component is zero, y component is maximum. Next, when x component becomes maximum here, the y component will be zero. So this electric field vector, it keeps on rotating. So this is about the circularly polarized electromagnetic waves. The last kind of polarization of electromagnetic waves is called elliptical polarization, and the electromagnetic waves are called elliptically polarized electromagnetic waves. In case of elliptical polarization, the magnitudes of x and y components, they are not equal, and they are also out of phase by 90 degree, means the phase difference between x and y components is 90 degree. So therefore, the net electric field rotates and it traces an ellipse. To understand this better, let us draw the axis. Let us say this is x-axis and this is y-axis, and let us say this is the initial direction of the electric field E, which is equal to the y component. When the y component is equal to the magnitude of the electric field itself, then the x component has a zero magnitude. then as this electric field vector rotates, the x component goes on increasing and the y component goes on decreasing. Okay, finally, when the electric vector is along x axis, the y component will be zero. So further, this electric field vector rotates and it traces an ellipse like this. So therefore, this kind of polarization is called elliptical polarization. This elliptical polarization could be well understood with the help of a simulation here. This is the x component and this is the y component. They vary with a phase difference of 90 degree and their magnitudes are also not equal. Therefore, the net electric vector rotates, its dimension will be maximum in this direction and minimum along this direction. You can just watch it here. In the simulation, you can see it is rotating. It is rotating in anticlockwise direction. The x and y components are varying in such a way that the electric vector rotates in the anticlockwise direction and its magnitude is also changing. This is because of the reason Ex and Ey are, you know, the amplitudes of Ex and Ey, they are not same. So with this, we complete the polarization of electromagnetic waves. Polarization of electromagnetic waves. At the end of the session, let us have MCQs to just assess what we have understood. Okay. The first question is, which of the following is an origin of electromagnetic wave? Per our discussions, electromagnetic waves are generated when there is a variation in electric field, when there is a oscillation of charges, or when there is an acceleration of charges. You can consider this. First option is electronic transitions in atoms, second option is nucleus, and third option is Bremsstrahlung, and fourth one is all the above. Electronic transitions result in light or radiation. Electronic transitions result in light, so that is visible light. Light is electromagnetic wave, so therefore this is the origin. Nuclei or nucleus emits gamma rays. Gamma rays are electromagnetic radiations of very high frequency, so therefore nucleus is also an origin. Then Bremsstrahlung strands for X-rays were called as breaking radiations. So electrons of high energy are directed on a metal sheet. When they hit the metal target, they interact with the atoms. When they interact with the atoms, they interact with the nucleus, they change their direction, there will be radial acceleration. During this interaction, radiation is emitted and that is called Bremsstrahlung or breaking radiation, and that results in X-rays. Therefore, all the three are the origin of the electromagnetic waves, and hence the answer is all the above. Option 4 is correct. The second MCQ states the velocity of electromagnetic wave in vacuum is. So this we did a derivation there. So C is equal to 1 over mu naught epsilon naught under square root. We get this value as 3 into 10 power 8. So since it is asked volume vacuum here, in case of vacuum, it is equal to C. If it is any other medium, it is less than C. This is never possible because the velocity of the light in vacuum is the highest, and hence the correct option is equal to C because it is mentioned here vacuum. So with this we have come to the end of this particular session, and I thank you for patience listening. Let us close the session with the quote by Sir C.V. Raman. So Sir C.V. Raman quotes, ask the nature the right questions. You need to ask the nature right questions, and nature will open up the doors to her secrets. So you need to ask the right question, then you will find the answer. So that's what is meant by Sir C.V. Raman. I thank you very much. All the best. See you.